Well, the Republican National Convention is just around the corner now.
Right now, live, right next to the bus behind us, Ron Paul is speaking. And seven of the candidates are here today. We have live pictures of Ron Paul, but you know what? We're talking about Sarah Palin, and we're talking about Rick Perry, the two people not in the race yet, Drew.
And guess what, Paul? If you get video of Sarah Palin or get a soundbite from her, bring that back to us. You can hold the Ron Paul stuff.
And as speakers hone their speeches, the city of Tampa is preparing for widespread protests, and they're apparently doing this by clearing jail cell beds in anticipation of mass arrests.
This worst-case scenario for Tampa and the immediate area.
We have a top tier. It is Mitt Romney, Rick Perry, and Michelle Bachmann.
The new top tier, and it's Perry, Mitt Romney, and Bachmann.
There's now a top tier in this race, at least for now, of Romney, Perry, and Bachmann.
I mean, I think it's fair to say, really fair to say, you're not forgetting, I don't know, anyone, say, an ideologically consistent 12-term congressman who came within less than 200 votes of winning the straw poll. Isn't anyone going to give that gentleman a little love?
You'd be right in the way, Wolf. You know, the way the Tampa Bay area is laid out, it is vulnerable to severe hurricane damage.
Top tier now of Bachmann and Perry and Romney, and, you know, we haven't mentioned, and we should.
Thank you.
We haven't mentioned, and we should, Rick Santorum, who did really surprisingly well for the amount of money and resources he had.
Rick Santorum? He didn't get half of what Ron Paul got.
The sheriff of Hillsborough County has ordered 1,700 prison beds to be cleared. That means relocating some inmates to handle the many arrests they plan on making. So what does this mean for protesters' freedom of speech, and are there already plans to silence them?
Before becoming an activist, I was never really interested in politics. I've always sort of understood that things were corrupt in government and corporations, but I didn't have an interest in working, you know, running for office or voting and things like that. But as the Houston Freethinkers began to grow in early 2012, we started to focus on how we could affect the political process, either highlighting the failures of it and the corruption that's taking place. And we started interviewing people like Herman Cain at the Texas Straw Poll, and then throughout the year interviewing local candidates from around the city. And for one, trying to show that there were options of people who were running for office that were legitimately trying to do good work. And also showing the you know, the corruption that was taking place, like on the national scale, what was happening to Ron Paul, the blackout of him in the media, and things like that. So as it got closer to August and the Republican National Convention, we were ready to go over there. We wanted to cover the counter protests. We wanted to cover the delegate process and the police state that was being erected around the city.
Having witnessed Robert's Rules of Order used in the 2008 state convention to help suppress delegate voice, I grew jaded with the political process and did not expect much change from the Republican establishment as a whole. I went to Tampa with the hopes of meeting people who did want to stop the war, who did want to stop the corporatism and actually take action in their lives on a day-to-day basis.
Our first stop was PAWFest. It stands for People Awakening and Uniting in Liberty. And it was based around the ideas of Dr. Ron Paul. And we went there not necessarily as supporters, as, you know, delegates in this process, but to go there to highlight, for one, the fact that he was the only candidate in either party that had a festival dedicated to them and to their ideas, but also to interview important people within the so-called liberty movement who are focusing on solutions.
And I want to make this really clear. If I thought Ron Paul was going to get the nomination, I would not be standing here before you today as the Libertarian Party candidate for president. I would have not done this. I would have let Ron Paul get the nomination, and I would be along with you supporting Dr. Paul right now. But this is an exclusionary process, and each and every one of you know it. This is absolutely exclusionary. You've had the sand kicked in your face, and you continue to have the sand kicked in your face, and you keep coming, and we all keep coming, because this is really an important message. And it's about the message. And Dr. Paul is the first one that will talk about the message. And the message is, look, let's stop the spending. Let's end the wars. let's abide by the Constitution of the United States. There is a growing police state in this country. Let's stop this growing police state in this country.
When Governor Johnson speaks of being an exclusionary process, but we come time and time and time again, well, that's one part I would say that is really deep in the core of HFT, that we are going to go boots on the ground time and time again, and that at the same time, it's going to be one foot in and one foot out.
And we're just here, you know, celebrating the legacy of Ron Paul, you know. For whatever criticisms, and I certainly have criticisms of him, he has been fighting for liberty for many years, 30 years, and you know, we have to love and respect him for that, and now we have to carry on the torch. So we're here, we've got a lot of great speakers here kind of teaching us on different options that we have to kind of carry the torch of liberty. Yeah, absolutely. You know, that's why I really love what the Houston Freethinkers are doing, what you guys are doing down in Texas, because I really feel that the community is where the solutions are really based, and it's really more about interpersonal relationships and spreading the message of liberty via those relationships. And for me, one of the things that I speak about a lot is politics is just kind of a venue to meet people who are already active, who are already like kind of activists, and get them on the right path and say, look, government isn't the answer, you know. So I get involved in politics for that reason, to kind of pull people out of that matrix. So I kind of advocate for like one foot in the matrix and one foot out, you know, doing the community things, doing the things that build rapport with people, that you can spread the message where they trust you. They love, you know, there's that saying, right? People don't care what you know until they know how much you care. So you need to establish that relationship, and then they'll be more open, rather than if you're going around with a clipboard ringing doorbells, please vote for Gary Johnson, please vote for Ron Paul. I mean, that only goes so far.
Yeah.
So
we are here with Brandon Smith. How you doing, brother?
How's it going?
Altmarket.com. So just tell everybody a little bit about yourself and why you're here at PaulFest, the ideas you're into, and what you're trying to bring to the Liberty Movement.
Well, I'm a macroeconomic analyst, self-taught. So if you ask me what my degrees are, I don't have any. I would say that my value as far as my work is my work. So just look at my work. If you think it fits, if it means something to you, if you think it's right, then you know then it's worth something. If you only care about degrees, then don't read my articles, I guess.
So you're self-taught, and what do you focus on? I mean, altmarket.com, what particularly are we dealing with as far as alternatives to the system?
Well, I'm focused, I mean, a lot of people complain about the Liberty Movement in general, and, you know, the major complaint is you guys always talk about how there's going to be a catastrophe, how everything bad's going to happen, but you never offer solutions to the problems. You know, I hear that argument a lot. And I would agree to a point. We do talk about disaster and catastrophe all the time. So my goal with AltMarket was to offer a solution, you know, a real solution, a bottom-up solution, instead of just going through the trials of politics, which are not working out for us right now. Obviously, you know, Ron Paul's kind of stepping away, and the movement needs something else beyond a top-down political solution. So what I want to do is offer the movement a bottom-up solution that starts with your local economy. Your local, the way you survive in your local economy. And I think people need, especially in the Liberty Movement, need to start separating themselves from the mainstream economy, focusing on barter networks, sound money, you know, just becoming more independent from the mainstream. Because ultimately what that will do will insulate you from any crisis that may come down the road. And you know, ultimately, you won't be affected as much. If we could get the whole country operating on alternative markets, then a collapse of the dollar means absolutely nothing. Absolutely nothing, because you've already set up an alternative system that works just as well, if not better. So what does it matter if the dollar collapses?
Exactly. So we continue to see, like you said, we're talking about catastrophes, the collapse that's coming, but we got to be about solutions. Because if we want to really do something with where we're headed, then we have to provide an alternative. And I think that we are more and more, like you said, we're seeing barter networks, we're seeing silver exchanges, free schools, Skillshares. We do a lot of that work in Houston, and I know more people are getting these ideas, and it's good to hear about that, because the collapse, however you want to look at it, is coming, but it won't affect you, like you said, if you shelter yourself and kind of
put a little barrier between us and the mainstream system, the mainstream economy.
Right. It's not, and it's not just, we have to make it about more than just alternative barter networks, and it has to be more than just alternative currencies and gold and silver. It has to be about community. It has to be about building real, solid, legitimate community where people work together and they aid each other and help each other because they want to, not because they're ordered to by some government entity.
A voluntary society.
A voluntary mutual aid society. That's really, I think, the ultimate answer to globalism. The ultimate answer to centralization is decentralization and localism. And I think that's what the ultimate answer to all of our problems, really. If we no longer rely on the system, then the system becomes irrelevant.
Our rights and our liberties do not come from Washington, D.C. They come from our Creator God.
You know, there's so much division already. I appreciated that you said you'd rather stand with an unbeliever who would defend the Constitution than a believer who would basically support tyranny, and I appreciate that.
Yeah, it's a fallacy to think that all we have to do is elect Christians and everything is going to be fine with the country. You know, we have to elect people that hold their oath of office seriously. And the oath of office means that they will support, protect, and defend the Constitution of the United States. If they're not willing to do that, they don't deserve our vote, they don't deserve our support. If they do that, then they deserve our vote and our support, regardless of whether they're Christians, white, black, Protestant, Catholic, that doesn't matter. What matters is that they will honor the contract with the American people to protect the Constitution.
I think that's what people in the liberty movement certainly expect. I mean, you know, we can judge them by their fruit when they deviate from that Constitution. You know, it gives us a basis. And just knowing that someone in general says they have the same belief as you, it doesn't give you that sort of ability to measure their actions. So I appreciated that you said that.
Thank you. The action is the way they cast their votes. And their rhetoric. A lot of people are unashamedly unconstitutional. I mean, both Mr. Barack Obama and Mitt Romney have both said things that are blatantly unconstitutional. Ron Paul has been the one mainstay on Capitol Hill that has maintained the integrity of constitutional government. And that is the duty of the American people, is to make sure that their elected officials are indeed holding their oath of office to support, protect, defend the Constitution of the United States. When it comes to government policies, we're losing ground fast. Where we are gaining ground is in things such as the Ron Paul movement. Now, I think that we have seen in the last 4 years a greater awareness among liberty-loving people as a result of the Ron Paul revolution than we did 4 years ago. So I think that the growth of that movement is growing exponentially the last 4 years. I think it's going to grow exponentially the next 4 years, even though Ron Paul's not going to be in Congress. I do think that his message is going to continue to resonate among the people. But as far as what's happening from Washington, D.C. and many state governments, we're losing ground so quickly it's hard to even comprehend. That's why I think another reason why the freedom movement is going to continue to grow, because the more you tighten the noose of tyranny, the more people are going to be inspired to fight for freedom.
So I'm glad I'm not one of the delegates, because I just don't think I can stomach all of that for too long. But I will tell you this. I will tell you this. I will tell you this. I do have so much hope in you. I have faith in you. I still have faith in our foundational documents. If we would only have local and public officials who will keep their word to uphold and defend, protect and preserve the United States Constitution. My dear friends, let's make no mistake about this. America is not dying because we follow the Constitution too strictly. Far from it. Let's have it as our goal. Let's challenge anybody in government, anybody in any of the other mainstream parties and the mainstream. Is there any way that you, the media, or the mainstream parties can follow the Constitution for 1 year? 1 year. Follow the Constitution. Okay, if after that it doesn't work, we'll forget it, we'll leave you alone, and we'll leave it to you. But what you have done, the Democrats and the Republicans, you have failed to protect and defend and obey the United States Constitution. You have failed.
Maybe asking yourself, well, Mr. Vermin Supreme, exactly what do you stand for? And I stand for four basic planks, and they are, of course, as follows. I am the only candidate who will fully fund time travel research. That's right, I'm the only candidate who will go back in time and kill baby Hitler before he is even born.
In Tampa with Vermin Supreme, your next president. So tell everybody more. What differentiates you between Ron Paul, Obama, and the rest of them?
Well, I'd have to say all those things that I just enunciated upon. Did you catch it? Did you see it? Did you hear it?
Well, I hear a lot about this pony economy.
Oh, yeah. I mean, Ron Paul, pony economy? No, I don't think so. No. Do they have zombie plans? No. Do they have mandatory toothbrushing law plans? No. Are they soft on plaque? Yes. Are they soft on zombies? Yes. Are they concerned about the real imminent threats to America? No, apparently not. So, once again, the number one thing that I have that all those candidates that you've mentioned have in common is they are refusing to debate me.
They're all refusing to debate Vermin. They don't want to debate him on ponies. They don't want to debate him about the zombie apocalypse.
No, I am here today to debate Ron Paul. Dr. Ron Paul, I hear you're here. I've heard you're going to be here. I want to debate you, sir. I know we came very close at Moe's Diner. Google it up. It's worth a giggle. And we're going to take it all the way. All the
awesome.
Way.
We're Vermin America. Supreme 2012.
Take it back, America.
Thank you. What's the matter, old man? Are you afraid?
What about Obama?
Obama? Oh, yeah, come on. Well, I will say tomorrow, on Monday night, I will be debating a Mitt Romney puppet.
It's the same thing.
Google that up. I debate all comers. I'll debate anything, anytime. I'll debate that bus over there. I'll debate that chair over there. I'll debate anybody, anything, anytime, about anything or nothing at all. I'm not afraid to debate, like, some Dr. Ron Pauls I could mention.
I'd like to just get your impressions on Paul Fest and what's going on with the Oath Keepers and yourself in the short term and just some reflections on liberty and whatever you want to talk to us about.
Well, you know, the reason why I'm at Paul Fest is because, obviously, it's a big part of the Liberty Movement. And one of my primary reasons I started Oath Keepers was that during the 2008 campaign, as soon as I was aware that Ron Paul was not going to be nominated, I knew we were FUBAR, whether it was McCain or Obama. And so it didn't make a difference which one was going to be elected. They're both oath breakers. And so I said, well, what can I do now? What now? So I said, well, I'm going to go and try to buy more time for the freedom movement to, you know, cause some uncertainty in the minds of the power elites so they don't try to pull the plug on the Constitution. So I'm going to go reach out to the current serving military, police, and firefighters and other emergency personnel and, you know, wake them up. Make them realize the obligation under their oath and what they swore an oath to defend, because they can't do it without them. And the big model we like to present for that is East Germany in 1989, when the wall fell, and you had the Communist Party freaking out. There's mass demonstrations, and the Communist Party ordered the army to go stop the demonstrations, and the army told them, you know, to go screw themselves. And they said, we're going to stay on base, we're not going to intervene. And without the support of the army, that was it. The Communist Party was done. And the Stasi secret police, who would have been so feared, were powerless without the army backing them up. They were running and hiding from the people. So that's what we want to see, is that kind of a peaceful, if it comes to it, that kind of a peaceful stand down. If we reach enough of them, it's just kind of like with the Patriot Movement or the Freedom Movement's trying to raise the consciousness in the general population. We're focused on that particular block of people because they're so critical. They could make a decision. They could make a difference between a peaceful restoration or revolution, whichever way you want to term it, or a violent one. And like in 1989, East Germany was very peaceful.
We're actually right now outside of the Tampa Bay Times Forum, where they're going to be holding this thing. There's National Guard everywhere. We've been seeing helicopters. We've been seeing Secret Service, all kinds of people, lots of things going on. So we're going to keep an eye on what's happening. Seems like the political system, the Republicans are up to their politics. The convention on Monday, it's going to get moved to Tuesday. So we're going to keep an eye on that. But for now, we're just checking out the city, and there's armed guards everywhere.
So another interesting thing I thought was how Paul Fest was organized by grassroots organizers. It was put together completely by activists from around the country. People like Adam Kokesh put a lot of work into it, and a lot of money and time and energy was spent trying to produce a huge event dedicated to the ideas of liberty and what Ron Paul was pushing in the mainstream for so long. And in the end, they were completely ignored by the Ron Paul campaign and Jesse Bitten. And instead, Ron Paul's campaign put on their own event, a Republican rally, which was pretty much an establishment-run event pushing people towards the idea of supporting Rand Paul in 2016 and to continue to work within the Republican Party.
This is no longer a question of whether Ron Paul and his ideas belong in the conservative movement. It instead becomes a statement of fact. Ron Paul and his ideas are the conservative movement.
He endorsed Romney.
I want to thank you for supporting my dad and also for supporting the cause of liberty and not letting our founding principles die. I give to you the guy that is my hero, the guy that is the greatest representative of the liberty movement in our time, my father, Ron Paul. That is what's happening today. The people now are waking up and they're realizing the failure of what we have and the reason that these ideas are coming about. Now, in this primary, we have close to 2 million votes. They say, oh, yeah, there's 2 million votes. That doesn't swing an election, da, da, da. You know, it's no big deal. But guess what? For every vote that we got in the primary, let me tell you, just from my personal experience of traveling around the country and meeting people at airports and wherever, the support out there is much, much greater, and they don't feel comfortable coming to a Republican primary. So the support there, I would say, be 2 or 3 times as much as the number of votes in the primary. That drives this whole philosophy is the rejection of violence. You don't kill other people, you don't take their property, you tolerate other people. And just think about this for a minute. Freedom should bring us together. It should never be divisive. Because in this room, there might be 1,000 different reasons why you want your freedom. You might want it for personal reasons, economic reasons, religious reasons, intellectual reasons. But if you all agree on liberty, you don't have to worry what the other guy's doing, the other person, or how they dress, or what they say, or what they do. We all should come together to defend liberty. My personal goal with my politics, my personal life, is that free society provides me an opportunity to seek virtue and excellence. And that should be a personal goal. And in doing that, it is better done in a free society. If the government takes over the rule of trying to make you a better person, an excellent person, and make you virtuous, it's all over. It's all over. That is the seeds of the authoritarian society. So instead of seeing this as a continuation of an era of the 20th century that gave us so much death and destruction, undermining our liberties, and conditions today that are so dangerous, let us think that we are now moving into a new era where we're going to concentrate on liberty and freedom and property and peace. I believe that is the cause that we should lead, and I thank you very much for being a part of it. Thank you.
You want to care about what others think? Guess what? You're not free. You're not free. You want to be a slave to someone else's? bad ideas? I don't think so. I don't think that's what this movement is about. Because that's the only thing that stops you from being free. What's in your own head? What holds you back? You want to be free in the future? You want to know what comes next? Patrick Henry ended that famous speech. I care not what others may choose, but for me, give me liberty or give me death. But you know what? I think he was asking the wrong question there. Because it's not that. That's not your choice. You don't have to die for freedom. And to say, give me liberty or give me death, is to say, you know what? You get to decide if I'm free or not. You get to decide if I'm free. You get to give me liberty or give me death. Fuck that. This is the evolution of the freedom movement. This is the evolution of humanity. And I take a long view of human history, and it's very comforting when you're able to step back. And you're able to see this as a continuum. Humanity marches on. Statism is a phase. We are evolving past. Woo! Woo! Yeah. Government is about to be rendered completely obsolete by technology and what we are able to use it to do to empower ourselves, to share information, because knowledge is power and it's in all of our fingertips now. With I mean, you had a computer that used to take a building to house in your fucking pocket now. We have kids who are in, you know what? I got an email last week from a fan telling me, hey Adam, I've been following you for a couple of years. I really like what you do. But you know, I really need some advice. I got some intense questions I got to get your help on. I don't know what to do, but I'm starting middle school next week. And you want to tell me voting is going to make you free? Really? Really? How much has the internet changed your perception of the world? How much has the internet changed your ability to stand up for what you believe in, to share what you're passionate about, to find the truth for yourself? And you know what? I'm fucking embarrassed about my story. You know how long it took me to go from saying, well, I'm a libertarian because I don't want to be a fucking Democrat or Republican, to actually getting the message? It took me about a decade. Yeah, I'm slow as shit. And then, you know, we used to joke, right? What's the difference between a minarchist and an anarchist? And just to be clear, that's anarcho-capitalist, voluntarist. None of the assholes with acid eggs that they're throwing at the RNC. No. About 6 months, right? That's so last year. You know what the difference is now between a minarchist and a voluntarist? About 2 weeks. So if you want to wait for someone to make you free, you want to see all of that coming, you feel that next generation coming up, no tolerance. When you grow up with the internet, you grow up with that truth button one click away, you have no tolerance for the kind of problems that exist for lack of information. And that's what we're doing. We're simply improving the market here, right? Staying true to our message about that. We are improving the market of information, showing that freedom is valuable. Freedom is something that you should want for yourself. You know why? Because being free makes your life better. And that's what you enjoy being part of this movement. You want to know the answer to the question, what comes next? Live free now.
Don't give me liberty or give me death. Don't turn to someone else to give you liberty. You are free just by your nature. And that's part of the reason I was in Tampa, was to find other people who thought like that and to find out how we can continue this revolution of hearts and minds.
So Paul Fest came to a conclusion, and it was it was an exciting experience to interview all these different activists, these different important speakers who are calling for the ideas of liberty. But it was also sort of disheartening to see the way that Paul Fest ended up being a huge disappointment in the eyes of some of the organizers. And in fact, video evidence shows that there was even warnings given to the speakers at the event to not work with the quote-unquote fringe of the liberty movement.
You might want to reconsider Paul Fest. I think it's bad news. Why aren't you guys involved? I wrote the bad people organizing a big fringe element. You're hoping the event goes away.
Despite the attendance being low, we got our interviews, we were able to collect information, meet other activists and network, and we continued on our way. We headed towards Tampa downtown to join with the Resist RNC protesters, who were there specifically to protest the Republican Party and the Republican National Convention.
Yes. Hey guys, so we're here in Tampa. We're outside the RNC, Tampa Bay Times Forum. Whole row of sheriff cops. We've got National Guard. I'll show them the fence behind us, right? Oh, that way. Everything's fenced in. Guards over there everywhere. You can kind of see on the live stream. There's fences all on the entire perimeter. We're walking up to the main protest. A whole row of sheriff's guards. Seems like they may be boxing people in or they're planning something. But we're going to find out. So stay tuned. Stay tuned to what's going on. Coming up behind, the sheriffs are coming up behind. So you guys see we're being followed by the left and right, there are bicycle sheriffs everywhere. But
first street actions we took part in was the Resist RNC March, where I was expecting to find thousands and thousands of individuals with unique ideas in opposition to the mainstream Republican Party. What I found for the most part was 1% Mitt Romney is evil, etc. But there were some signs that I did take faith from later when I saw the video. In the Fed, stop the wars. So I knew there were people out there working for a better world and to help end corporatism. So that was a really good thing to see. And the Resist RNC March, I think, was the longest march that was held, and there was nowhere near the numbers of 2008.
Yeah.
But they're still talking for Obama.
We need no Obama!
No Obama!
No Obama!
Outlink the two-party system!
Down with the two-party system!
Break your chains right and left! Break your chains right and left!
No Obama!
Break your chains right and left!
Obama!
No Rambama.
No Obama.
No Obama. No Obama. No Obama. No Obama.
Well, I voted for an honest politician. I'm here, as well as all of us, for our families, for our friends, and for the evolution of our species. Thank you.
Hey, so you're wearing this because you're part of the march, right?
Yeah.
They only have a certain chance they're approved to say, correct?
Who does?
The people with the megaphones and the orange jackets such as yourself.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know if I'd call them approved. We do have a list that we've been going on, but...
Let's go up here because they're about to funnel people in. And look above there.
Look up there.
Fucking water! 5, 6, 7, 8, 5!
We're going to the freeway, they're supposedly funneling people in here. You can see a whole shitload of cops,
bike
cops.
They're
starting to trap everybody in here. We're coming further. We're about to see what happens. And like Cody just said, there's only certain specific chants you can say out here. But we're out here screaming, no Obama, no Rambama.
No Obama!
Fuck the two-party system. They may know the Republicans are the problem, but not everybody knows that the Democrats are the problem as well. Obama and Romney and Bush, and none of these motherfuckers are investigating
Don't
Goldman Sachs or anybody. They're all corporatists. Remember that.
Yes, it is. Break your chains right and
dissatisfied with the overall turnout. I think it was the chilling effect. Maybe it was due to FBI activists such as Brandon Darby. For those who don't know, Brandon Darby is an FBI informant. He was an agent provocateur whose actions led to the entrapment of two activists in the 2008 RNC. I'm not sure, but at the same time, the city did accept the grant money to help step up the police state efforts around the RNC, and we did all pay for that. Yet the numbers, they were much slimmer than before. I think in 2008 there was over 1,500 arrests. The number of arrests in 2012 was minimal.
Afterwards, we ran into David Crowley, who's a filmmaker working on the upcoming Gray State film.
Here at Tampa Bay at the RNC, Police State 2012. I'm here with David, Gray State. They're working on the Gray State project. Go ahead and tell everybody a little bit more about that and what you can see in the future.
Well, the Gray State has many definitions, but this is certainly one of them. It's a film about, I mean, if you look around, this reminds me of Iraq. You've got K-rails and fencing and everyone's contained. It's like a military post. You know, so freedom is essentially corralled in the center, and that's the Gray State. You know, the gradual decline of freedom and liberty toward this sort of like lockdown, where you can say what you want for now, but you're going to be monitored and maybe even picked up later. Who knows? Yeah, this is a film about that.
So it's a fictional film based on the possibility of the coming from the state that a lot of people
are saying. Right. I mean, there are filmmakers all over the place here, I imagine, who are doing documentaries about the real stuff. But what I'm doing is an actual narrative film, which is pretty different. You know, I mean, it's Hollywood, so it's a story. So I think, like, I consider it like a Trojan horse in the mainstream media, because people go to theaters and see this, not expecting to be given a message. But, I mean, human stories communicate to a larger audience than just the documentary filmmakers. And get to people who are already on board anyway.
Should we expect a
sense of hope for
from the film?
From the film?
Do you look around and see a sense of hope? I mean, you've got fences, guys on either side of the fence. I mean, it's so visible now. That's what the Gray State is, because the lines have been drawn. But the guys over there saying all the stuff they're saying, do they know what's going on? Do you see hope with this, and do you see hope with that? I don't. And I don't think you're going to find much hope in the Gray State. But through that narrative storytelling, you will find some human truths that we can attach to, like the non-aggression principle, for example.
This is very popular amongst all you guys, I know. We want to get all the free stuff. Where is my free stuff at? Nobody wants to hear this, do they? I understand. This is truth. But I want to tell you, too, inside that RNC right now, we've got 500 Ron Paul delegates that are fighting the system right now. They're saying, we're not going to put up with this GOP bullshit anymore. We're going to stand up and we're going to tell you that we want smaller government. We want sound money. We want these laws that have been passed, like the NDAA 1021 and H.R. 347, repealed. That's on the platform. That's what all the patriots are doing within the political system. They're not going in there saying, we want more government, more money. They're going in there saying that we want smaller government, sound money. We want to have equality for all people, rights for everybody. No more war! Yeah. Everybody thinks that Republicans are about let's go to war. That's bullcrap. I'm from Minnesota. We took over the Republican Party. We changed the entire platform.
No Romney,
whatever the hell you want to call it. No left, right. Let's separate it all. Let's have this awakening of the people. But, or we can go to our tents and like sing Kumbaya fucking ya.
Yeah, we're not really, we see the TSA in there, you can see them. Cody's getting video.
So here we are, the TSA is inside the building.
The TSA is here at the, what is this, Greyhound bus line? Actually, TSA is at the Houston Greyhound bus line too. This isn't Metro, so I guess they have another thing. They've been so entrenched, they have this large sign up that I imagine is up at every bus station. This is a new front, we need to get out.
Open the door for me again.
We need to, this is a new front. This is the 610 Polk Street, TSA, not in the airport and where their jurisdiction ends, groping people, Fourth Amendment violations just because of the RNC. The rulers come to town and all of a sudden it's okay to grope people on the buses. Be aware, Tampa Bay, you need to stop it. Stop the TSA in your city. It's not just in the airport.
So, we're out here in front of the Greyhound station. We're at Morgan and Polk, Tampa Bay. The battery's getting a little low, so I think we're going to keep moving on. We're going to go up here to this next little barrier right here and show you the big fences. And like we said, we're not even near the Times Forum right now. I mean, we're a good 10, 15 minute walk.
We're tired away from there.
That's
all.
The last video, we walked by 4 or 5 minutes straight of cops, and we discovered the TSA on Greyhound buses. So we're coming up here now to this, and if it dies again, we'll plug in, we'll get back on. There's plenty more action, so you guys hang out. Check this out. Big fence.
Oh, here we go. Turn right.
And whoa, what do we see here?
Federal Protective Services filming us.
Cars over there. There's a lot of stuff happening. I think the rain's picking back up, so we're going to keep moving. A bunch of cops, bikes, fences everywhere. There's DHS right there, Federal Protective Services. That's DHS right there, Federal Protective Services. He took our picture. So yeah, we're just getting footage of this. I'm going to go ahead and stop this for right now. Cody's up there. Micah's there. Oh, wait. Maybe we got something more to watch. This cop's watching us. Let's get him. It's a free country. He can take a picture of us if he wants to, and so can we. So I'm going to walk to the other side of the street. Yeah, I know.
kind of want to go over there to that side of the street. We got a green light. Let's walk that way. I'm going to walk.
There's no sidewalk.
Well, those guys just walked. I've got a green light, a sidewalk, sidewalk closed. I'm going to walk along the perimeter of the fence. And we'll see what happens.
Let me carry the stand. You already got the backpack.
Cody's on that side. We're going to walk past here and see what this guy's doing. Is he taking pictures of us or what he wants? Federal Protective Service. Federal Protective Service. U.S. Government. G42167 5H for official use only.
It doesn't expire until 2017.
But he doesn't have to buy new plates. But yeah, so that's that cop. There's more.
One thing I'll say is all these fences also have FPS on them, so we know where they're from now.
So all these fence works provided by the Federal Protective Service. Watch out, go the road. We got two more DHS coming here, FPS.
I don't want to be here.
We're good. We're good. Everybody's cool. Just keep moving. Just keep moving. Keep moving. Let's not stop. Keep filming. Keep moving. Our cameras are our weapons. The world is watching, and these guys know that. Homeland Security, keep moving.
Yeah.
What's that?
That's my deal.
No, I don't.
You ain't no idea.
Why are we being stopped for? What are we being stopped for?
She's my
DNA. My name is Micah Jackson. Okay. I'm not going to be able to identify myself.
We'll ID ourselves, but we don't have any.
All right, let me explain something to you, right? We're not Miami. We're not Florida or anything like that.
I'm from Texas. I don't have my ID. My ID got stolen 2 weeks ago. I just got a new license before I came here. I don't have it yet.
So you don't have anything on it?
I mean, I have a birth certificate. I carry that with me.
That's fine. That's called ID.
I mean, I don't want to be held illegally or anything like that. I don't want to be
held illegally.
Well, right now, in a way, I feel like
the law.
So what are we being detained for now?
That's the main question, because I know my rights as far as being detained.
You're filming a federal compound and a security measure. That in itself is against the law.
This is a federal compound?
Yes, it is.
The fence?
Everything behind the fence.
What's that building? Look up his address.
Where's the birth certificate?
I can get that if you need it. I mean, but I just still feel like I don't...
Listen,
I can tell you my name, my full
game.
Birth.
I don't want you to tell me anything. I want to see something. Well, I can hold you for 72 hours. It's your choice. It don't make me no difference.
I'm going to give this guy my ID. If everybody knows, we are live streaming right now watching this. I'm going to give this
Both
guy my ID.
The ID
I believe my rights are being violated. I'm telling them not to throw an ID myself. They're threatening to detain me for 72 hours,
We're
so I'm going to give my ID. I'm being forced. We're surrounded by DHS, Homeland Security, Federal Protective Services. They're saying because we
for
took
documenting
pictures,
the RNC.
Because of documenting pictures that we should do this. I don't want to go to jail. I don't want to get held.
Here in this parking lot. We're being basically detained and questioned for walking through with cameras that everybody has here at the RNC.
We're surrounded by cameras everywhere we go, but these guys think they have extra rights.
We were being filmed. It's another one of those examples of one rule for them and one rule for us.
They're above us, apparently. It's okay for them to take pictures of us, but it's not okay for us.
Exactly.
But it's not okay, but we're stopped for it. But we couldn't
can
stop
I
you.
You're asking for ID? He won't let me get away without ID myself.
We can't leave.
I'm being threatened to be detained for failing to ID myself for walking around and doing the same thing you're doing.
This is what we get for trying to get the word out to you about what's going on here.
This is the federal government out of control.
This is extremism.
They say that might is right because they've got guns and because they're threatening to hold us for 72 hours, they know that they can threaten us. And so I can tell him my name, I can tell him everything he can find out from there, but that's not good enough for him. He can still make the same radio call and read in the same information, but that's not good enough for them because they know what's best.
Then what's the point of all that connected computer grid?
They're being searched by Homeland Security right now. They're being searched. This is what a police state looks like, everyone. This is a police state.
We're with the radio show. We're out here documenting everything. That's why we're here.
Yeah, everybody's seeing this. We've got viewers watching this right now. This is going to be loaded up. I'd like all y'all's badge numbers, too, if possible.
My first name, Derrick. David Edward Robert Edward King.
Delta, Echo, Romeo, Romeo, India, Charlie, Kilo.
DHS, Department of Homeland Security, same department of the government with FEMA. These guys may be good, but do you guys recognize that you're enforcing violations of the Constitution? Free people are allowed to walk around and take pictures, just the same way you are. But what gives you the authority to declare that you have to have my papers? Papers, please! This is fucking Nazi tactics. And I respect you guys as human beings, but I don't respect what you're doing and violating my rights and believing
honestly,
that there's...
I think you got involved in this to do something good and keep people safe. But if we don't have any freedom, we're not really safe.
Exactly. Benjamin Franklin said, those willing to give up liberty for security deserve neither. And you guys are asking us to give up our liberty to be safe, and we don't buy that.
Giving up our right to travel.
We're just here to document, not to cause any trouble.
I gotta say on a positive note, is hopefully these Department of Homeland Security individuals are here to more or less defend Americans' rights to be out and document their political process rather than to exclude people from it. But we remain to find out what's going on for real.
And I want if anybody thinks that we invoke this by walking across the street with a camera, if you think that you live in a country that you're not allowed to
it's
walk across the street and record, then get out of America, because America's based on freedom. It's not illegal to film
the
police.
Work harder to change it.
Federal government or not, it's not illegal to film anybody. And they're trying to set up one rule for them, one rule for us.
You got the weapon on me? Sure.
Yep. What? All I got on me are strings.
Yes, I do.
This thing is a camera tripod, not a stiff.
If you check your bag and you're standing on federal property?
We're on federal property? On the street?
Just come on federal property.
The street is federal property? The public street right here that's paved by tax dollars?
You pay your tax dollars to the state and to the feds, right?
So the federal government, I'm just trying to understand, like, as soon as I walked in the street, I turned on the federal property?
No, when you sit up here and you came on this into the state of Florida, yeah, you were on federal property.
So all public space is federal property, according to that.
So let me ask you a question. Why can't you look in your bag?
I didn't think about that. He asked if I have a problem with that. I do have a problem with that.
So can you look in your bag?
If you're going to do it anyways, you might as well do it. You're not
even looking in your bag. Yes or no
question? There's really no yes or no question, because when I was asked if I need to give my ID, I was threatened with being detained for 72 hours. So if you're going to tell me I'm going to be detained for letting you go to the bag, just quit the bullshit.
Go ahead and violate the Fourth Amendment.
But are you going to do it anyway? I don't want you to do it because it's my personal space, because I have a Fourth Amendment that protects me.
There's nothing in there, which you'll find out soon as you search it.
But I'm still going to argue with you because it's my stuff.
Like you said, anywhere we walk in the state is...
This is my private property.
We're not directing, we're asking permission.
Pardon me?
We're not directing, we're just asking permission.
Okay, thank you, sir. All right. He said we're not directing, we're just asking.
We're not directing you to open your bag, we're asking your permission.
And I'm saying that I would rather not, because of my Fourth Amendment. I would like to exercise my Fourth Amendment to not be searched. That's all. I mean,
this guy here? Mr. Rose, is that a yes or no question? I mean, it's a yes
just
or no
the answer,
question.
No. Yes or no.
No, you're free to go.
I would not like you to
they know.
Is that a yes or no?
That's a no.
Thank you very much.
Can I get my card back and such? Things about that. They told us that anytime we were on federal property or video in a federal building or federal thing, compound is what they called it, even though it's just an office building that's what they got for this.
Once we were through with the Department of Homeland Security, we decided to hit the streets of Tampa. We were basically looking for delegates who were either supporting Ron Paul or Romney and just trying to get their opinion on the whole situation. Also looking for celebrities and anyone that would be interesting to speak to about why they supported Romney or Obama.
We're here in Tampa. We are talking with
Dr. Ada Fisher, the North Carolina Republican National Committee woman.
Well, thank you for speaking to us. And we've been
I'm a free thinker, just like you all are.
And that's who we're looking for. We're looking for other free thinkers and people who are thinking freely and during this election time, during the convention. And just wanted to, I guess, get your feel on how things have been going.
I think things are great. You know, people get a bad impression based on the storm, but as you can see from these lines out here, it's not putting a damp on people's enthusiasm or activities here.
Awesome. Yeah, we've seen a lot of people. We've also seen a lot of police and just different things going on in the city. So,
right.
And the hurricane, of course, has been impacting everyone.
Right.
I wanted to get a feel for
the convention, as we're moving towards it actually, you know, officially opening tomorrow, it seems all but sewn up that Mitt Romney is the official.
I sure hope so. I love the man. I think he's going to be a great president, and I would encourage everybody to support him.
How would you say that Mitt Romney differs from, say, President Obama?
Well, I think that this is an election which promises to offer you contrast. In our state, we have a poet named Robert Frost, and Robert Frost wrote a poem called The Road Not Taken. And he says, two roads diverge in a yellow wood, and I chose the one that's traveled, and that has made all the difference. In this election, the contrast is the Republicans are saying we must stabilize the economy, we must have some way to reduce our bills. The Democratic Party still says let's increase taxes, let's increase spending, and we can't. When you look at the budget, you will find that we are now spending over $3 trillion for entitlements for Medicaid and Medicare, and we don't take in but $2.7 trillion. So we are spending more money than we're taking in, and that doesn't even include defense and other things. And if this nation doesn't want to end up like Greece, it must be solvent. And to be solvent, we have to make some changes. But the changes have to be fair, and safety nets have to be in place. And we will fight to make sure those things happen.
Does Mitt Romney, from your perception, support like our current wars in Afghanistan, Iraq?
I don't know. You'd have to ask him. I can't comment on what he supports and what he doesn't support. I can tell you that he is for a strong defense, and he does support Israel. And as a Jew, I'm very interested to make sure that Israel is defended and supported.
Could you maybe tell us, you know, what you see as some of the main differences between the candidate you support, Romney, and President Obama?
Well, basically, President Obama's had his 3.5 years. He's had his term, and he hasn't really done a lot of the things he promised. Romney is more of a business point of view and perspective. I'm a businessman myself, so I kind of feel that, you know, we need to take more of a business approach towards government.
Certainly, I appreciate that. We need to manage it efficiently. Even today, there was an article, I believe it was in the USA Today, that said voters are growing tired and find very little difference between the two candidates. Do you maybe understand why they might be saying that? Some of the issues they say they're similar on are economic policy and the wars, and that troubles quite a few people in both parties.
Well, I take a look at President Obama when he ran. He promised he was going to end the war in a very specific amount of time. He didn't do it. In fact, he sent an extra 30,000 troops to Afghanistan. My cousin's done 4 tours in Afghanistan and Iraq. So, you know, I kind of know a little bit about that. One of the main differences I feel is in their philosophy towards government. The president is a big government guy. Romney is a business guy. Everything has a cost.
Do you have any problem with your candidate receiving funds from the same sources as his opponent, Obama?
I don't have a problem with candidates taking money from whomever they're comfortable taking money from. But what I will say is this: Goldman Sachs is a very big, Goldman Sachs is a very big firm on Wall Street, and they're going to hedge their bets and give money to all sides.
Well, you said it well. You said it well right there. Is there anything you'd like to leave our listeners with, our viewers with?
I think it's time for a change. Obama came in claiming change. He didn't make very much change. Government has grown. Virginia is like one of the wealthiest states now because so many government workers are in Virginia. I think we need to take another look at the big government approach. I don't think it's the proper approach right now. We're in a lot of debt. We're mortgaging our grandkids, and I hope to have some soon, and I'd like them not to take on quite so much debt.
All right. Here we are. This is serious business. Down here, we've run into another presidential candidate. There's someone here besides Romney to think about, you know, get out of the two-party system and get out of the middle. Get out of the middle.
What's up? This is Derrick with the Houston Freethinkers. I'm here to debate this little piece of shit.
Yesterday
at Pawfest, you said that you had a time travel plan where you would go back and kill baby Hitler.
I'm going to go back in time and kill Ron Paul!
If you go back in time and kill baby Hitler, somebody much worse is going to grow. How do you respond to that? Your time travel Hitler plan does not work.
Ron Paul will save us!
New baby Hitler will save us. How do you respond to critiques of your pony plan? Your pony plan is going to contribute to
respond to no critiques of my pony plan.
See this? He's unwilling to debate me. He's full of shit.
ponies will save America.
He's unwilling to debate me on that tactic, and he will not respond. I'm talking to him like a gentleman, and he won't answer me. Do you understand? Do you understand what's happening? This is the man you want for president. This is the man you want for president. Down with Vermin Supreme. Vermin Supreme is evil. Kill this man. Get rid of him.
First one in the dental education center, brother.
He's coming for your teeth.
Thank you. My name is Vermin Supreme. I approve this message.
Next up, we went out at night for a roving dance party. Footage looks a little silly. You know, we're walking through the streets, we're dancing with the golden elephant, Vermin Supreme's blasting music out through his bullhorn, and honestly some of it was a little silly. We were out there, we were having a good time, we're documenting what's taking place. The numbers of the protesters were extremely low compared to 4 years earlier at the 2008 Republican National Convention, and largely it seemed like this was just a joke for some of the people. There definitely was an Occupy crowd out there that had come from New York and from other places and seemed to be there more just to party and to camp out.
One out of all of them, so he's got the most to prove.
Once again, of course, it's a beautiful evening, it's a beautiful dance party, there's no problems, no worries, and of course, until y'all started blocking us, everything was swell. So it's all good.
We're still here in Tampa. It's Tuesday and the Republican National Convention has officially started. You can see it behind us. You see the fence behind us. There's, of course, all the armed guards everywhere. We're going to continue doing our job, documenting everything. We're going to be trying to get interviews with delegates again, media people. We're still on the lookout for Geraldo. We almost got him yesterday.
We're busy.
busy with other things. And we're also going to be attending a march later this evening, just continuing to cover the police state and everything that's going on. Hopefully we won't be hassled by DHS or Federal Protective Services anymore. And we are also going to be checking out some action down the streets. Supposedly there's a lot of Ron Paul people here. And also with Ron Paul, we're getting word from within the convention that Ron Paul has showed up with the Hawaiian delegates, and that there was a lot of chanting for President Paul that was continuing on. And we're waiting.
Let him speak. Let him speak. There's a lot of chanting for let him speak. Let him speak. And we're going to see what's happening. Maybe they can at least reverse some of the bad rules that were made by the rules. And
I actually just got this. He was here for about 10 minutes, but no chanting then. Before the start of the convention, there was both Ron Paul and Seat Main chanting, lots of it. Seat the Main delegate. So Ron Paul and Seat Main. So yeah, there are people within the convention who are chanting and letting it be known that they're not happy with the way this thing is going. So, you know, thank you to everybody who's within there and still trying to bring some message of liberty. And at the very least, like, whether you support Ron Paul or not, this system is not even following its own rules.
Vermin Supreme is back again today.
Do you think he'll have a lasting effect on it?
Absolutely he will, because he's getting in the minds of young people, and that's where our future is. And it doesn't matter who our president is or who our government is or what they control, we control ourselves. Whether he's the president or not, we control ourselves and we control our destiny and we manifest our destiny. And if we can think free and we can feel free, then we can live free. If we can do that, it's a success.
On fall.
Burmese main capital firm has helped set up the communist Chinese surveillance system. And they go after dissidents. They go after people.
As you can see, Ron Paul is the only candidate that has supporters who are willing to go out there to put one last ditch effort into convincing these delegates to look at Ron Paul as an option.
Vote for the only candidate left in this race that understands economics. Vote for the defender of the Constitution and the choice of the troops. Vote for the choice of the troops.
Don't vote for more government like Bush. This is the answer.
Say no to the Goldman Sachs candidate.
I'm delegate in 08. Here you go. I'm Micah, bottom of the list. Derrick or Micah, we're here.
You got me. Yeah, I'm from Vaughn's district. So.
Awesome. Please give us a call if you got anything you want to say.
Stepping in the puddle.
They're going to come.
Are they allowing anybody closer, or is this as close as people can get if they don't
this
have
this is as close as you can get.
And this there is, like I said,
you got National Guard. You have National Guard troops here. Trying to prevent, you know, any individuals from going over there and exercising their First Amendment right.
All delegates are unbound. Call your conscience. Vote for your own right. Thank you
very much.
There's a lot on in there.
Call your conscience.
Call your conscience. Restore America.
Vote for yourself. Vote for all of us.
Another interesting happening was when we ran into Westboro Baptist Church. Yes, imagine that. Westboro Baptist Church, of all people, were protesting the Republican National Convention. So we talked to them to find out exactly why they were protesting, but we also heard a very interesting fact.
But at the end of the day, it's kind of hard to misinterpret
if your right eye offends you, cut it off. It's better to enter heaven maimed than hell whole. What is unclear about that? What is unclear or subject to interpretation about remember Lot's wife? What's unclear about that? Those are plain words out of the Lord Jesus Christ. You all want to worship and talk about him at this convention. So-called, we got Christians running this convention. Now go swing a cat and hit 8 out of 10 divorced and remarried, which Christ said is adultery. Now, you're going to, with a straight face, tell the fags that you're interested in the sanctity of marriage, Mitt Romney? No, they're laughing you out of that convention hall. Barack Obama's going to win because Barack Obama was appointed to destroy this nation. These faux Christians are going down.
God hates America, the dying soldier's home, because it's the lying preacher's home.
Yeah, we're here to tell Mitt Romney and all of the Republican Party that the greatest threat to civil liberties and religious liberties in this nation today is the Republican Party. They pass these laws and they think they can shut up a dissenting voice. There's no other nation in the world trying to shut up Americans but America.
I'm sorry, ma'am. You have the stage at 4:30. You have a permit. You have your First Amendment right to say and do whatever you want to do. Okay? But this group also has that right. I'm just trying to get you some physical protection.
Welcome in.
So, are you okay where you are?
I'm requesting legal help, other than not letting them.
It's up to you.
So, as the Resist RNC protesters come running up to protest against the Westboro Baptist Church, I see the sheriff officers grab one protester immediately and take him back to the side. They start going through his bag. They wouldn't allow the National Lawyers Guild to come speak to him, any of the lawyers to get over there to advise him. And as you can see, they just went through his entire bag and questioned him.
I got a group coming. I don't want any confrontation. I would prefer that you would be behind a barricade so that you will be safe, so that you don't have physical confrontation.
Hey, here comes the march, everybody.
You let them behind the barricade.
And they're searching this guy's bag over here, violating his Fourth Amendment.
This guy just walked up and they took him over there and searched his bag. And violating his Fourth Amendment right there.
One of the other things to note about this is, so the protesters were told to come there to protest the Westboro Baptist Church, and then all this taxpayer money is spent to bring the goon squad in there, the sheriff's deputies, to protect the Westboro Baptist Church and then to escort them out of there. So you see how they use our money during these events to protect the whole city. They set up these fences all around the city. They put in all these officers. They open up space in the jails. And all this money is coming from the taxpayers who are losing access to their city. And these protesters themselves are actually paying for the protection of the people they're protesting against.
Where are you guys going?
Michael, we need to separate you for a minute. I need you to back off for a little while. Just back off for a minute. Step back. Micah back so you can all protest.
Make some space for
the here they come. They're moving in. They're moving in.
Why are you guys attacking these bigots?
Many, many cops. Moving in formation.
Loving you, officers.
Hey guys, so we're here. This is a protest that's supposed to be going on. There's an anti-gay protest going on by the Westboro, and they bring out the fucking goon squad, dude. Check out the whole line of armed guards.
I'm not sure who they're keeping safe here. I don't think anybody here was about to get violent. They're just separating us. This is what division does to us.
This is what division does to the American people. We need them between us. We're letting them between us.
This is the point that freedom's got saved.
Instead of public policy, there is absolutely zero reason for you to be here, number one. Number two, if you are here, well, just keep chill, y'all. Ain't no situation. It's all under control. Your services are no longer required. You may return to your homes. Time for a nice cold beer. 12 hours on, 12 hours off in the hot sun can make anybody a little cranky, so let's keep it professional, people. I expect nothing less than pure professionalism from the people that are sent to the
to platoon, excuse me.
Yes, sir, or are we just adding more to the mix for fun?
They have shields this time.
Protesters. It would help even our number now.
Here comes Westboro being guarded by the Sheriff's Department.
The Westboro Baptist Church group.
They have this group escorting them, and the new group is continuing.
So if you're coming,
he has a paintball gun right there, as you can see.
Special escort.
Officers. And here are the anarchists. Black flag leading in.
This is definitely a little clusterfuck. Okay, y'all, you got the troops are trying to walk behind you, make a little space.
Please, officers, we're trying to get through.
I know, you can get
blocking pedestrian
just
traffic.
These folks get by.
Let the riot police through.
We are pedestrian traffic.
It's riot pigs. Please use the correct.
Watch out, guys. Watch out. The hole for the police!
After we left the Westboro protest, we headed to the voter suppression march and rally.
What good are
oh, what do you want me to say?
We're here at the voter suppression rally.
Undocumented workers who've been working with immigrant rights groups around the state of Florida. People of the right, she's a dreamer, came here.
undocumented from Costa Rica. She's been given.
What's up, guys? We are here at the voter suppression march and ran to a friend of mine, Tennessee Truther. Good friend. We're going to talk to him in just a minute. He's around here actually passing out 9/11 newspapers, asking people if they've ever heard about the Architects and Engineers investigation, if they've ever actually watched the videos and seen the buildings collapse. So it's good to see that as we're gearing up close to the 11th anniversary of 9/11, there's still people all the way out here in Tampa trying to bring the truth to the people. So let's catch a little bit about what he's doing.
This shows that the building didn't collapse, really exploded. All the concrete turned into fine powder and then air.
Saying that we need to have ID in order to vote. That means all the poor families, that means all the seniors, that means all the Latinos and African Americans and the poor whites in Pennsylvania. And this has got to change. It was under the Obama administration that we saw the same amount of money as George W. Bush spending on the military. And I saw the consequences to my black and Latino and white and Native brothers and sisters. And I said, this is it. We need an independent political party in this country. We need to take money out of elections, and we need to take our country back and build a country that's based on human need and not corporate greed.
He's saying basically that Texas's microphone was cut, and there's nothing that Steve Monastery could do. The RNC killed his mic, business as usual, and basically everything has been ignored, that they basically have no reason to be there at this point. The RNC hates the grassroots is the message that this pretty staunch, I wouldn't call him staunch party line individual, but there for the cause, to say the least. And he's coming out saying RNC hates the grassroots, becoming more and more a top-down party, it seems, from what we're hearing on the floor. And Romney is the nominee. Get ready for 4 more years of Obama.
So explain a little more, like they turned off the delegates from Texas mic so they couldn't speak out.
Yes, they shut the mic down. I'm not sure if they're how using Robert's rules they were able to. I don't know if they just didn't want to hear it anymore. I know in the state of Texas at the state convention in 08 we experienced a lot of the same thing, and it sounds like just authority keeping the mics off, keeping the voice down. There were folks coming in from Virgin Islands, from pretty much every state, on part of delegates and teams, and mics are cut off.
Outside the system, we're just here to videotape and remind people that the two-party system is
dead. Some people got to scream out,
say no to Obama! Break your chains right and left! Think outside the two-party system!
I found the voter suppression rally in March to be some of the most fun and exciting things. It was there that I found people that I would expect to meet on the streets and less agenda-driven. That's where I met people who were out, who were just tired of things, tired of the war, and out having a good time meeting people.
Again, we're witnessing diversity of tactics. Some people are for voting and they want to keep marching. Some people want to block the streets. In a free world, we can all coexist.
So when it comes to march, guys, the march is being divided.
From my perspective, a lot of these marches and rallies seem to be dealing with mainstream issues and pretty much just repeating the same rhetoric that we've heard in the past from the left and the right. I mean, this happened from the voter suppression march, from the very first Resist RNC thing, dealing with the delegates. Everywhere we were going, it was either people calling for extreme right Republican perspective or Democrat perspective, and this included the women's right rally.
Women in crisis across the country. My story is more of the story of thousands of women in this country, women who are simply trying to achieve their life goals and maintain their health at the same time. And I know that some people think that being a student is easy, the easy life, but the truth is that these days we are juggling quite a lot. In addition to classes and studying, we also have to pay for tuition, we have to pay for books, we have to pay for groceries and rent. And the one thing that I truly do not want to worry about is whether or not I'm going to have the health insurance or access to health care I need when I graduate. And that is why I am so grateful to have a president who has stood strong and worked tirelessly to expand access to health care for young women, older women, students, etc., etc., etc. Hard work.
Hey, it's Micah here. I'm talking to Casey, who came up to the RNC just the other day, getting ideas why she's here, why some of the different people have come here, and what they might hope to get out with their voice. So, what motivated you to come to Tampa, and what do you really want to get out or say?
What do I want to get out? I want to get the Republicans out of my uterus.
Sounds good.
I just want them to know that they don't control everything. They seem to think that the helicopter is flying everywhere.
have our right to free speech.
Thank you. Thank you.
And that there are other opinions in the world. They blind themselves from that, but...
Certainly. Don't be dogmatic. You won't see all points of views. It's hard to talk to other people when you're like that. There seems to be a large sentiment that if we could just stop the Republicans, everything would be okay. Do you think that's... How much weight would you give such a statement?
I mean, it would be helpful, but there's... The whole bipartisan system is corrupt, and everybody needs to change.
So after interviewing Casey, we headed back to Camp Romneyville, the base of operations for Resist RNC.
Derrick, we're still in Tampa. We are here in Romneyville talking with Amos.
How you doing?
Good. How are you? Very good. And so you are one of the main organizers with Resist RNC, correct?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So we want to just, I guess, let the people know what brought together, you know, the organization for Resist RNC, where are you personally coming from, and, you know, what your purpose is here?
Well, first of all, I stand for a world that works for everyone and everything, so that's basically what I use as my guiding kind of principle. And through that, I met some people when I was within the Occupy movement that were interested in organizing for the RNC. So I joined up with a group that had other activists as well. And over time, just through the struggles of this community's activism, or it's, you know, it's, we don't have a heavy activist community like other cities, which is probably one of the reasons they chose Tampa. But through over time, our group got very small. So by default, I became one of the main organizers, because otherwise, really, this is really one of my first gigs. So by default, there was only a few of us organizing. So we carried the ball forward and did the best we could, and worked hard to get this camp. We fought city councils on their ordinances. We controlled the media debate about what is really going on, why the RNC is militarizing the downtown. And I think we've had some success, a lot of success, bringing the message to the. We've had a lot of success before the RNC even started. You know, the message is out there. The people are losing their fear about what this is about. They're not scared to come out and check out the protesters. They realize everyone here is speaking on behalf of them. They don't need to fear the protester like the city was trying to make them out, demonize them. So I think we've had a lot of success bringing the issues to the forefront, and it's been an interesting process. Yeah.
So what kind of events have you guys had going on throughout the week?
There's been several permitted marches that other groups have put together. Our group in particular really doesn't like the idea of a permit. We feel that we have these rights, and by asking for a permit, it jeopardizes it. It basically gives power to the state, and it suggests that these rights are privileges.
It legitimizes the state.
It legitimizes it, yes. So what we've done, and we announced them too, we announced that we're doing an unpermitted radical march, and we were coming from here and going to march through downtown. The city has said that they're not going to allow that to happen. We pulled it off with no incidents. The police handled themselves well. The protesters handled themselves well. So it was successful. We promoted to the law enforcement before we even got started this week a press release to them stating that we're not here to confront the police. We're here to be nonviolent, peaceful protesters, and our message is to who they are protecting, not the police themselves. That's a distraction. So we're here to confront the power elite and the corporations. So with that, we had a spontaneous march yesterday. And here's an interesting thing. We had, Westboro Baptist Church was going to do an anti-gay rally. It's permitted in the public viewing area. We had law enforcement ask one of us to organize a counter-protest. It's unofficial. They may never admit to it, but it doesn't matter. We started bridging the divide. We did go and counter-protest that. We had an anarchist group, and they were very disciplined, very ordered, very structured, and they maintained a good sense of nonviolent pressure, and it went off without incident. The success is that we're getting a good message to the media. Nothing's distracted us from the message. No incidents are occurring that's taking us off point. This camp has been a magnet for media. We've got a lot of not mainstream media, but we have some mainstream media, but mostly independent media, which is super important, and as well as foreign media, which is also very important, because we get a lot of countries looking and wondering why we're not uprising like we should be.
Exactly. And so as Resist RNC, as much as it is an organization in that sense, how do you personally, and I guess most of the camp here, stand on the position of the Democrats? I mean, are people here because they believe Democrats are the answer, or is it generally there as a feeling of disbelief and disenchantment with both parties?
The disenchantment with both parties. Friday, this changes from Romneyville to Obamaville. And then we caravan over to the DNC. Both parties aren't representing the people. They're a duopoly. They're representing corporate interest. And our message, the underlying message in all the groups here is that our representatives are not representing the people, and then we're taking our country back.
Definitely, man. Well, thank you for taking the time to talk to us.
Thank you.
I really do think that this was a amazing experience to go through with other activists, people from around the country, and of course with two friends, two other activists from Houston, going there with the hopes of documenting what was taking place there. I mean, we felt the effect of the police state firsthand by getting detained. We were witness to the way the delegates were mistreated within this supposedly democratic system. We watched protesters call for more of the same without even realizing it. We saw the whole spectrum of events, and the amount of protesters was a bit disappointing. The police presence was way beyond any protester presence.
Well, we went to Tampa, and they will break the rules. They will cheat, they will lie, they will not seat your delegates. That's what they do in the political system. But you know, it takes people in the political system putting that foot in, going there to let you know, like the delegates let us know, seat Maine. It takes people like Dr. Paul going to stop the war. You know, it takes people from all parties, from all walks doing things. And yes, as you go into these things, you'll see people that are mindless drones that do say, oh, our party line, whatever it is, right or left. And you'll have other people that'll talk to you about breaking your chains right and left. And that means thinking free and thinking for yourself. And I thank goodness for every individual that I met in Tampa and the people that sent me there, because in doing that, it helped revolutionize my heart and my mind to see that this is happening across the country. There are people thinking for themselves throughout the land. There are people who have podiums given to them to help get this message to people. So thank you for what you do for it.
For me as an activist, this was a huge turning point. This destroyed any hope that I may have had in mainstream politics and putting my faith in voting within their system, even in the delegate process. We watched it from the primaries back in Texas, and we watched the end of the process in Tampa Bay when the Republican National Convention showed itself as a complete joke and farce. Mitt Romney, as you know, went on to get the endorsement and to lose to Obama, and we have now another process continuing where in 4 more years people will clamor for 2 more guys to try to save them from the situation. For me personally, I feel as if this was the last time that I even considered working within that system. And now all my efforts as an activist have gone towards focusing on community building, trying to find local solutions for these issues, because we can't ignore these people. We can't ignore the Obamas or the Romneys that come in, the people that get put into these positions, because they're making decisions that affect our lives. But I think we can find more direct ways to change things and to really better our lives. They ignore these protests. A few hundred people coming to Tampa Bay outside of the Times Forum, separated by miles through huge fences. I mean, it's obvious that as soon as the leaders come to town, the police state is going to take over. Anyone who questions it, who gets in the way, will be hassled and harassed. And the point is fear, the point is intimidation. But I think as we move past working in their political realm and try to seek real solutions, we're going to find we'll be more effective. This whole experience for me really affirmed my belief in creating a voluntary society and the ideas of agorism. It's about us focusing ourselves and our communities and looking at the problems that we face in the political realm, environmental, everything that we're dealing with, and trying to find a solution that we can take in our own lives and a solution that we can give other people, steps that we can take to empower ourselves. And that's what agorism deals with, building community alternatives, taking steps to free yourself more and more every day. And that's what I'm focusing on more and more after this experience. I really appreciate the ability to go to Tampa, to report on these events, to experience this and to learn from it and to bring that message back to our friends and family and fellow activists who supported us. So thank you to everybody who donated, to everybody who gave us an interview, everybody who shared the videos, and everyone who's part of the Houston Freethinkers and has continued to allow this group to grow.
Because of the empowerment that I feel when I meet people working towards solution, I hope to continue to meet people working for solutions, and I hope that they feel that sense of empowerment too. I'd also like to thank everybody involved in this movie. Thank you, everyone that did anything to help us. Thank you. Love you guys. Yeah.
Don't never give up. Everybody needs haters in life. Don't take what they say to heart. Use it as inspiration to keep doing you. Yeah. I spit these righteous bars. Mine shines like the brightest star. Life's a battle, I hide the scars. I try this hard because I'm determined to see every boy and girl in this world learn to be free.
We're here at the RNC. Vermin Supreme is taking over. Mitt Romney is down. Obama's up. We don't know what's going on. The delegates are running around. Everybody's sick and we're all throwing up. The anarchists are here with their confetti eggs. They've got silly string. Things are getting violent down here. Please get here as soon as you can. Send recruits. Send the Easter Bunny. Send anybody you can. We need help.
When I see people thinking that it's hopeless, I tell them separate body from mind and refocus. The coldness that cripples in the night quickly dissipates when you get a bit of light. The wisdom I'm giving to those in prison will in time expand the mind and mold decisions. Behold the vision here with all my people. No race, no class, all of us equal.